Monster.
Hey everybody, and welcome to your latest episode of the Hogsty. It is the week before the 4th of July, which is one of the better holidays that we have in this country. It's in my top two, because, you know, you got that and Thanksgiving. Those are really the two American holidays.
I love the 4th of July holiday, but it also kind of stinks when it's on a weekend.
Yeah. Well, at least, I don't know about you. I know you never take vacation days or holidays anyway. You're a workaholic, Steve. But, like, everyone generally gets the third off, at least, if it's on a Saturday.
Really? Yeah. See, who knew?
Yeah, well, it's a federal holiday. Most people get it off.
See, it's best when it's on, like, a Monday.
Oh, yeah. Of course.
Because I don't like the Friday holidays as much as the Monday holidays, because the Monday holidays just seem to make the week a lot shorter for some reason.
Ironically, both make the week shorter, but I know exactly
really ironic,
what you're saying.
And
the older you get, the more you just embrace the 4-day work week rather than the 3 days off. That's the other thing I've picked up on.
Well, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
And
so I didn't know that the federal government had the 3rd of July off. I don't think I've ever had the 3rd of July off.
Well, if a government holiday falls on a Saturday, you get the Friday off. If it falls on a Sunday, you get the Monday off.
See, I wonder if I had that when I was in the military, and I don't even remember it.
You probably you worked some weird jobs in the military. They probably didn't give it to you.
I worked all through all sorts of holidays.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Occasion, so, yeah.
I don't know about your neighborhood, Steve. They've
been shooting
off.
Yesterday, by
the way. Hmm?
I got a coronavirus test.
Oh, did
yesterday.
You?
Yeah.
The antibody one?
No, I got the.
Oh, just the thing up your nose. How was that?
It was. First of all, I don't have it. You know, it's somebody I know. The girlfriend, who's been in my house once, had it, and so I thought, out of an abundance of caution, let me get the test. But I feel fine, and I don't have it.
Good.
But it was. I didn't even look at to see how long the nasal swab thing was. I really didn't want to know. I just said, he looked at me and said, "Do you have any questions?" I said, "Just do it, man.
Yeah.
Just get it over with." But it was, it felt like somebody's probing your brain briefly for a couple seconds, and it was uncomfortable. And then they did the other one, but the whole thing lasted, you know, 10 seconds.
Yeah.
You know,
I've heard my wife had it done twice, 'cause she had to go to the hospital once and they do it like crazy. I am actually getting it done on Tuesday because I'm getting the antibody test just to see.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Just to see?
So I think
– I thought about that.
You know,
yeah, but the antibody test is a blood test, I think, is how they do it, right?
Yeah, the antibody's blood, but I believe they do the nasal swab at the same time.
Oh, do they?
Yeah.
The whole thing was – I did a drive-through thing run by the state of Texas. Whole thing, I was in and out in 5 minutes.
That's
cool. It was okay. I mean, it's not something I'd want to do all the time, but it was – for anybody who's worried about the test, it looks worse than it is. It's uncomfortable for literally a few seconds, and then it's over.
Sure. And, you know, look, if you feel sick, get it. That's my mentality. You know, we're better off knowing who has it and getting them quarantined. So, you know, even if you're one of those people who doesn't, you know, want it, you know, want things shut down, it's better to know than not know.
Well, that's why I did it.
Yeah.
And, you know, and listen, I mean, the girl had been in the house, you know, let's just get it done and, you know, just make sure.
Sure. All right. Well, I was also going to talk about fireworks, but we've vamped enough now.
What about fireworks? Speak up.
Well, okay. So I don't know about your neighborhood. People have been shooting fireworks off in my neighborhood at like 1 a.m. the past week. So that's been – I haven't slept well the last few days. I'm just going to
put
that
up. I live in a middle-class suburb. We don't do that here.
Yeah. Well, and you have an HOA that would probably, you know, burn the person's house down or something.
We also have a city that says it's illegal to shoot fireworks in the city.
Yeah. I don't know what the laws in D.C. are. Doesn't matter. They're shooting off fireworks.
Well, I wouldn't necessarily put a lot of faith in the government of D.C. to control things like crime.
Yeah. Not that kind of thing these days. All right, let's get into the latest news with the Redskins.
Which is not much news.
Not much, but we had a two-parter from early in the week. One we just missed on last week's show. It happened like that afternoon after we'd recorded. But I want to start with the Redskins. George Preston Marshall, they continue to get rid of a lot of the stuff around him with this team. They're pulling his name out of the Ring of Fame. and they're removing it from the first tier of the Redskins Stadium, which I guess is called the George Marshall tier or something like that, the right. George Marshall level. And they're replacing that with Bobby Mitchell, whose jersey number we also saw them retire this week, which, you know, probably past time that that happened. You know, great thing that they did there. But let's start with the George Preston Marshall stuff real quick. So, like I said, they're taking his name off the stadium. They're taking it out of the Ring of Fame. Steve, I know you kind of thought that they might have gone a little too far with the Ring of Fame thing. Is that yeah. right?
No. Not the Ring of Fame. I'm fine with the Ring of Fame because that's honoring the people that did good. I'm fine with not honoring him in the Ring of Fame. What I had a problem with was them taking him off the website.
Oh, off
because
the website.
At some point, okay. you know, I don't want to necessarily celebrate the guy, but the fact of the matter is he's the founding owner of the Washington Redskins.
Sure.
And, you know, he did good things and he did bad things. Was he a bad guy in terms of racism? Absolutely. But that doesn't mean you just – I'm not in favor of ignoring history. You know, if I right. were the Redskins, yeah, I'd definitely take him out of the Ring of Fame. I'd definitely not name the lower bowl or whatever is named in FedEx Field
after
him. Which,
by the way, did anyone even know that was named after him, really?
I never knew that. And yeah. we know everything about this team, and we didn't know that. But what I do have a problem with is let's take all vestiges of George Preston Marshall and throw it in the trash can because it's so offensive. That I have a problem with. What I would do if I were the Redskins, I would own it. I would just flat out own it. And the team history – I would leave George Preston Marshall in the team history and say he founded the Washington Redskins. He drafted Sammy Baugh. He brought the Redskins from Boston to Washington. He was an avowed racist who refused to integrate the team till till they brought in Bobby Mitchell in 1962, mm-hmm. was it? I would just put it all out there because I think if you ignore the people who – this is the same argument I have against doing things like tearing statues down. It's – one, it's stupid, but two – the way to not repeat history is to not ignore it,
Right.
And it's a part of – it's a major part of the team, and to just pretend it didn't happen is doing it a disservice.
And I agree with you that you can't pretend he didn't own the team. Like
– Right.
And you and I are in different, spots, I think, to an extent with the whole statues thing. But the whole – like to me, like when it came to the statues example, you still have history books. And you still have museums and you still have this knowledge of, all right, this is the terrible stuff that happened and the good stuff that happened. And you, like you said, you just have to own up to that. Not everyone – most of history is bad people. Like if you really want to break down anyone who's remembered in history, they're pretty terrible up until a certain point when we finally started –
I think they're complicated.
Yes.
It's complicated more than and listen, I'm fine with like – if you want to tear down the
we've talked about Confederate stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm not in favor of number one are the rioters and looters who are tearing stuff down. Those guys are idiots and they're felons. They belong in jail. I'm fine with like cities taking them down, organized fashion. Sure. Cause again, I don't necessarily think you should celebrate those people, but just to pretend in some of these, the statue rioters don't know what the hell they're talking about. I mean, they're tearing down, Ulysses S. Grant statues. That's just freaking stupid.
Yeah. I saw somebody tried to tear down deface a statue of the guy who wrote Don Quixote.
And yeah, I saw that.
And I'm like, that doesn't make any sense.
Well, and they wanted to tear down the statue of Lincoln. It's just ridiculous. But as to George Preston, and then we're getting off on another topic. Yeah, yeah. As to George Preston Marshall, I'm fine with taking out the stuff that's honoring him. I'm not fine with erasing him from the website and pretending he didn't own the team anymore because just the name George Preston Marshall alone sends people into conniption fits, apparently. That's just stupid. He was the founding owner of the team. You don't run from it. It is what it is. Put it out there right. and list both the good and the bad when you're talking about the team history. Right. That's what I had a problem with.
Yeah, I think we're in agreement there. It's okay to say this guy owned the team and he was a terrible person.
Well, he did some good things.
Sure.
Put the accurate part of it. Did he found the team? Yes. Did he move the team to Washington, D.C.? Yes. Did he draft Sammy Baugh?
Yeah.
Yes,
sure.
He did.
Okay.
And then here's the other side of him. And just don't sugarcoat it. Put it all out there. Truth, good, bad, and ugly. That's right. What I would do.
Sure.
But now, don't honor him. For sure, I wouldn't honor him. I'm in agreement. The tweet I put out was just relating to taking him out of the history book, if you will.
Sure. Well, let's talk about the guy who they are honoring now in his place, and deservedly so. Bobby Mitchell, they retired his jersey, makes it only the second jersey number the Redskins have ever officially retired, along with Sammy Baugh. there was a lot of talk about who else should they officially retire. I'm not really interested in getting into that aspect of this, at least not this week. When we have a very slow news week, maybe we'll do that as a discussion.
Is that not today?
Yeah. Well, we got a lot of wide receivers to talk about later.
True, we do.
Let's talk a little bit about his background. He, you know, comes to the Redskins. What was it, 1962 or 1961?
I believe it was 62.
Yeah. Here's some history factoids that people should know. Bobby Mitchell, for all the talk, technically not the first black player the Redskins ever had, because they drafted a fullback and signed him before they traded for Bobby Mitchell. Because the trade couldn't go through until the end of the season. The draft was in the middle of the year back then. So there were like a lot of weird things like that going on. But Bobby Mitchell is the first one to play for the team, because that fullback never actually made the roster and played. He was only signed through
camp.
Well,
you're talking about Ernie Davis.
No. I'm talking about a guy they drafted in that same draft with Ernie Davis, who they drafted in like the fifth or sixth round.
Yeah, you're right, because they did draft Ernie Davis and immediately traded him to the Cleveland Browns.
No, not immediately. Secretly 2 weeks later they did it.
You're right. Yep. My mistake. You're right.
So, and then the trade couldn't be complete until after the season, and that's when Bobby Mitchell came to the Redskins.
Right. Yeah.
So, like, but still, Bobby Mitchell is credited as the first black player for the Redskins, because he's the first one to actually have played, not the fullback whose name no one remembers because he didn't actually play ever.
Right,
But Mitchell gets a lot of credit for that. Also, just an amazing player for his time. I saw somebody said if you took his stats from his best years as a receiver here, because remember, it wasn't a 16-game season yet, and if you pull him out to a 16-game season, he's a 2,000-yard-a-year guy for a couple of seasons.
I think he was the 1960s version of Marshall Faulk.
He really was. Well, he was a wing back and a running back and...
Marshall Faulk did all that stuff.
Yeah, exactly. He was even more dynamic than Faulk in a way, though, because I Faulk almost always was out of the backfield, and this guy, and you know, he could go everywhere. Mitchell,
I don't know why they didn't do this a long time ago. I know you don't want to get into it, and we won't, but I don't really understand the Redskins' deal with not retiring numbers. I don't really get it in the first place, and I think several of them should be retired. I thought this was a bit pandering to do it right now. They should have done it a long time ago. And it struck me as a little bit that the Redskins are sort of pandering to society right now by just choosing to do it right now.
There's a little heat to, you know, do good things like this. Now.
Yeah. What you should have done is retired his number decades ago.
Well, when did he retire from the team? Because remember, he was in the front office forever, too. Was it 2002 or so?
Well, he retired from the front office in 2003, I believe. So
that's,
the history
that's the
here
year
is
they should have retired his number.
The 2002. So yeah, so he played from 1962 to 1968 in the front office, 1969 to 2002. He finished, if everybody remembers, he was the assistant general manager, and he was kind of mad at the team because in 2002, Dan Snyder actually passed on him to be the GM in favor of
Vinny Serrato. Yeah.
Yeah.
And that was back after he'd already fired Vinny once.
Yeah. And I kind of understand that. And, you know,
I think we all understand that.
Yeah. And he probably did deserve it. But yeah, that's when they should, at a minimum, at least then, they should have retired it then. And probably well before that, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you're talking about 50 some odd years of service to this team. As a player and in the front office then. You know, that's incredible.
Well, 62 to 2002.
Okay,
you know,
so what is
the number? So
yeah.
40 years.
40 years, 40 sorry. Years. Not 50. But
it's a long time.
I don't know of anybody who spends 40 years with one company anymore.
Well,
much
see,
less,
even put aside the fact that he was a pioneer,
right?
You know, for the Reds, put that aside.
A Hall of Fame player,
regardless of the racial undertones of his service to the team, he still deserves to have his number retired. He's a Hall of Famer. You know, he was one of the first true dual threats
Right.
You know, he was with the team for 40 years. That man should have had his number retired a long time ago, regardless
should have
of
had
it. And then you throw in that he's basically the NFL's version of Jackie Robinson, and it's just – it's inexcusable they didn't do this before the, now. And, again, it seems like it was a bit pandering to do it now. And what they should have done is done it when he was alive, not after he's dead.
Well, that's true. He did just die a few months
ago. In April, I believe. Yeah, April.
Yeah. I think it is pandering. I don't even think the Redskins are shy about admitting that this is pandering to an extent at this point.
I don't think they've literally used the word pandering, but no, they should.
No. I mean, but I don't think they're like hiding it, you know, that that fact. But
no, there's no there's a reason why all this happened now.
Yes,
there's
of
a reason why they got rid of they didn't, Dan Snyder didn't just wake up and decide to dump George Preston Marshall.
No,
the Redskins showing you know that they are listening to society about the racial unrest that's going on.
Yeah, I think so. And again, though, I think the one thing we can't emphasize enough. Now, you and I are not old enough to have seen Bobby Mitchell play, but
no.
When you look at his numbers and you look at what he did, there's a good reason why a guy like Sammy Baugh gets his number retired in that he kind of changed the way quarterback is played. Bobby Mitchell is like – he changed the way that the whole running back receiver thing happened. Before him, you had receivers, but most guys didn't do what he did numbers-wise. Like I don't think – I think he set the record a couple years, didn't he? I might be wrong about that.
Well, you want to hear some numbers?
Yeah, give me some
talking
numbers.
Talking about okay, so career-wise, this is both including his time with the Cleveland Browns and with the Redskins. He has got 521 receptions for 7,954 yards, 15.3 yards per reception for rushing. 513 carries, 2,735 yards, average 5.3 yards per attempt, which is amazing. And just with
both
the Redskins
both those numbers averages are incredible by any standard of any era.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
15 yards receiving and 5 yards rushing, those are nuts.
With just the Redskins alone, in the 7th season with the Redskins, 98 games played, 85 games started, 393 receptions, 6,492 yards, 16.5 yards per reception, mm-hmm. which is – that's like DeSean Jackson territory.
Yeah.
90 carries, 438 yards, 4.9 yards per attempt. Unbelievable numbers mm-hmm. on both
and
sides.
He really did, like I was saying, he kind of lined up in a lot of weird spots, but he's
– He did.
He wasn't a traditional, like, out on the edge wide out. Like, if you watch his highlights, he's a – he's almost like a tight end. They called him
he can do it all, though.
Yeah, they call him a wing or a flanker back in those days.
It was truly before his time.
Yeah. Yeah, he was playing weird positions that don't exist anymore and just putting up nuts numbers.
Crazy, crazy numbers.
Yeah.
Yeah, truly before his time.
Right.
So he was, you know, I think I could comfortably say he was a pioneer of the game.
Mm-hmm.
Forgetting again the societal racial implications of it, just in the way he played, deserves every honor and was kind of a pioneer, and he would fit in well today.
Yeah, a guy like that, that versatile, you know, like the game is built around guys like him now.
Imagine what Bill Belichick could do with
him. Oh yeah, he would be Gronk on steroids, you know. You know,
yeah, Gronk was a lot bigger than Bobby Mitchell, but yeah.
Well, I meant in terms of talent, not physical steroids.
Yeah, exactly.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes. Bad analogy, maybe. Gronk on steroids.
And Gronk is a bit dumb and a bit crazy, and Bobby Mitchell was neither of those.
Yes.
Neither dumb nor crazy.
Yes. Very smart dude. I mean, obviously, he was in the front office forever under Casserly. By the way, think of that. He was in the front office under Casserly and Bobby Bethard for all those years, too. Like, just a wealth.
Yeah, I think, I think it was Casserly. He was Casserly's assistant GM. Let's think about the timeline here.
He would have been Casserly's,
Yeah, and so then Casserly got fired in favor of Vinny. And so that's the time that Mitchell should have been promoted to GM.
Yeah, so that would have been 1999.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But right. Okay. So I'm with you. So anyway, yeah. I mean, obviously, very smart. You know, completely different than Rob Gronkowski.
Yes.
Totally.
Yeah. I don't see. I mean, Rob Gronkowski retired and was selling weed, and Bobby Mitchell retired and went into an NFL.
He was doing what?
He was trying to sell medicinal marijuana or something.
He was.
Yeah,
oh, I didn't.
Yeah.
God, I've had enough of Rob Gronkowski.
Yeah.
He was, although we're going to see him again. He's back.
Yeah, you know, yeah. With Tampa, I don't know how that's going to work because he's all thin now. Like, he lost all the weight.
Well, I mean, it's not like he couldn't put it all back on.
I guess.
Just pop a few roids.
Yeah.
Get some shots in the butt. You know, get back out there.
Yeah, because it's true.
Yeah, I mean, come on. Am I saying something?
Nope.
You know, off color, nope. Color here? No. That's what he's going to do.
So, Hall of Famer at wide receiver. Let's just say wide receiver, even though, again, his position doesn't exist today because it's a different sport. So wide receiver. Right. And that fits our actual main topic today because we were going to go over the Redskins wide receivers roster as part of our position group breakdown, which why don't we get into that?
Okay.
It's a very interesting group in my mind. A lot of youth, a lot of potential. But let's start with the guy because we know he's going to be the number one, and that's Scary Terry McLaurin. In here last year. We kind of had hopes for him. Because we knew he had some talent, but man, did he kind of set the NFL on fire in his rookie season.
I can't honestly say I saw this coming with him. What I thought of when I saw Terry McLaurin is he's a burner. He's going to be the next DeSean Jackson. He's going to be a deep threat. He's probably already has, he obviously played with Dwayne Haskins, so they're going to have good chemistry. I didn't watch him enough to know that he was such a great route runner.
Mm-hmm.
We know that now. I can't say I saw that coming. In terms of numbers, 93 receptions or targets, 58 receptions, 919 yards in just 14 games. So he would have been over 1,000, comfortably over 1,000 yards had he played a full season.
Yeah.
And as a rookie, that's crazy. 15.8 yards per reception, 7 touchdowns, along of 75. That's what he did last year, again in 14 games. That's, again, bringing him along slowly. Mm-hmm. That's playing for a coach who was stuck in 1968 in terms of the offense,
yeah.
You know, in Bill Callahan. And Jay Gruden, frankly, was a mess, you know, at the beginning of the year. So think about what Terry McLaurin can do with a better coach, with a quarterback who's one more year in the NFL, and they've had time to work. I mean, the sky's unlimited for this guy. And I think what's most impressive to me about him is if you really study his route running, he really knows how to get separation. And
he does.
It's not just his speed.
So,
you know, it's his technique, his footwork, mm-hmm. the way he moves his head. You know, he knows exactly when to make moves and when not to. He's an outstanding receiver in every way.
He really is. And when I went through the wide receivers, I was like, you know, watching tape on all of them this morning just to get ready. He really is a perfectly balanced receiver. Like I know you love to say who's the X, who's the Y, Steve. That's kind of how you like to think of receivers. You know.
Well, he can do it all.
He can do
everything.
I
just say that because that's where
yeah.
you know the team lines him up.
Right, right. I prefer to think of guys as like what their role is, and he's a balanced receiver. You can put him everywhere on the field. He can go deep. He can play mid range. He can do the shallow crossing stuff. He can do whatever you need him to do. And he's dangerous no matter where he is on the field. Here's what I think is the most mind-blowing thing about his numbers. The first game, we saw him blow up Philly, right? He had like 120-something yards. Second game, he had a great game too. Team started adjusting to him. He still had a great season. And there was no one else on the roster to like pull off coverage or, you know, it was just him. He was the only real threat for most of the year. So it's really impressive that he had the numbers he had with that in consideration.
Darius Slay said that McLaurin was the toughest cover he had all year.
Mm-hmm.
Darius Slay, Pro Bowler, Detroit Lions last year, switch teams this offseason?
I think so.
Regardless.
Yeah. I remember there was Redskins fans who wanted him.
I've never liked the term number one wide receiver because – you know,
the
analyst
define.
In
yeah.
me, yeah, says this is subjective and this is undefined and what does this mean? And I still don't like it. But in terms of McLaurin, he's the number, look, what it means to me, I guess, is he's the number one target.
Right.
In the receiver core. It's Terry McLaurin. He's going to always go up against the best corner on the opposing team. They're probably going to shade coverage towards him. They'll take safeties and shade him his way. And, that having been said, what we saw last year is that there's no reason why he still can't beat all that and have
last year. I know his numbers did drop a little, especially again, you're talking about Bill Callahan, who hated to throw the ball's offense. But
he tore up Philly again at the end of the year, though, 130 yards in week 14.
And that kind of look, I don't think you ever see a receiver get like just 100 yards a game every game anymore. They're always going to have little feasts like that where they have one big day and then a couple average days. But he's shown he can be a number one, as you hate to say. But to me, what he is, it's one guy who you want on the field every snap. That's what it is. Like, right. if he's not on the field, I want him just getting a drink of Gatorade and coming back out. Like, that's the guy you want out there as much as possible.
Here's how I can describe Terry McLaurin. Remember Donald Parham, the tight end?
Vaguely.
Who was in camp for 5 minutes?
Yeah.
I was intrigued by Donald Parham because he had a lot of physical gifts. He was very tall. He had humongous
catch
wingspan.
Radius, yeah.
He was fast. And so I watched Donald Parham's college film, and I even forget what college he was from. From small school, but regardless, watched his college film, did a film breakdown on him. Donald Parham's problem was he had no moves at all, zero. He was really a slot receiver, not a tight end, and that's a big reason why he didn't make the team. But regardless, if you watch Donald Parham's film, his footwork was very basic.
Sure.
His hand placement was very basic. He basically made no fakes, for lack of a better term, in any way. If it was a post, he'd run out. He'd when the appropriate moment came, he would make his break, and that's it.
Yeah.
If you watch and study what Terry McLaurin does, it's light years ahead of a guy like Donald Parham in the way he uses his feet, the way he uses his – where he looks, where he turns his head, when he turns his head – the speed he uses, he's not just running all out all the time. Where he puts his hands, he knows when to turn in, turn on the jets. It's light years ahead of a guy like Donald Parham. And as a rookie, that's a really, really rare thing as a rookie.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I love about Terry McLaurin.
Yeah. He's
the anti-Donald Parham.
And he's got so many raw skills that are just obvious.
Oh, yeah. And he's only going to get better.
Yep.
I mean, he's a rookie, and it was a rookie on a bad team. Mm-hmm. He's going to get better.
All right, let's go to the guy who last year I think was your wide receiver crush, and that's Steve Sims Jr. Let's do him next. You started touting his praises early on. I remember, like, right after.
I think I was the first one.
Yeah, you
to
definitely
be honest.
On our show, definitely, and probably even generally. Like, I didn't hear a lot of people going nuts about the guy. Came in, beat, Quinn for that slot job pretty quickly.
Right.
And, kind of has replaced what Jamerson Crowder was for us for the last couple of years, is just that perfect little slot guy who gets open shallow and can get the ball and make some yards with it. And he's a good, decent kick returner too. Let's not say great, but decent kick returner.
I love how you called him little, and it's funny because he's 5'10".
Yeah.
It's not little in the real world. It's little for a receiver.
Well, but
that's
he's
funny.
Also only 170 something, right? Or 180 something.
Yeah, he is. I first noticed Steve Sims right after the draft. I did a film study on Jordan Brailford.
Mm-hmm.
And I was watching the Oklahoma State Kansas game for Jordan Brailford, and I kept seeing this little dude just tear up the secondary. I thought, who in the world is that? Oh, wait. He's a Redskin,
yeah.
And that's how I first noticed him. And I think I even tweeted about it then, said, hey, watch for this kid, Steven Sims. He's awesome.
Yeah.
Steven Sims is another guy who's pretty advanced.
Yeah, yeah.
In his route running. He knows how to get separation also, and it's not just about speed with him. And the Redskins, surprisingly, did a pretty good job of using Sims in creative ways.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't just line him up on the slot all the time. He's a perfect jet sweep receiver.
He really is.
For example.
Yeah.
But some of the times the Redskins have had problems with is you have a weapon like that and you only put him on the field when those gadget plays are going to happen.
And that's what they did with him probably the first half of the year too.
Right.
If he was out there, you knew he was only getting a jet sweep or maybe he would get like a screen pass or something.
But it became more than that. But at the end of the year, yes. And he became a regular, and he's good enough to where he can just own the slot. Mm-hmm. I think he can own the slot.
Yeah.
And he's not just going to be Mr. Gadget Play. He's not going to be just Mr. Jet Sweep. I think he's advanced enough, and he's only going to get better to where he can be a legitimate, scary starting slot receiver.
Yes, I agree with that. And to me, with this team kind of lacking a traditional tight end to kind of be the safety valve, you need a guy like Steve Sims, who's like that slot guy who's just going to get open shallow, like I said before. And if Haskins can't find anyone else, he's got that, you know? That can be his role in this offense for a year as just that safety guy.
Yeah. At some point, this team's going to have to find a tight end.
At some point, but it won't be this year, and we all know that.
Yeah. We did our tight end breakdown already, didn't we? I think so, yeah. But regardless, yeah, Steve Sims. He's little by NFL receiver standards. He's fast.
Right.
You know, he's another one that's in the 4.4 category of speed. Last year, the Redskins, 2018 Redskins were severely lacking team speed.
They were.
This group has got a lot of team speed. You know, Terry McLaurin is a legit burner.
Right.
Steven Sims is a legit burner. A couple of these other guys that we'll get to are burners too.
I will say they have speed. They're not DeSean Jackson speed. We don't have anybody like that yet. But
I think DeSean Jackson is one of the best deep threats in the history of football.
Right. But
it's not fair to compare.
There's maybe
to
five
that.
Guys like that in the NFL who have that kind of speed at any time.
Cordero Patterson.
Yeah.
You know who's there's a
the guy in Cincinnati who's always hurt. You know,
Tyreek Hill probably.
Hill's up there.
Point is, there's a handful of them.
Right.
Yeah, I agree.
But these are our guys who can help you take the top off for the most part. Although, again, Sims, you don't traditionally think of him as a guy you would send on a fly route. You don't, like, at least when I watch him, I just think of a lot of crossing routes, a lot of, you know, short.
Well, that's
mid.
Because he's a slot receiver. Right. That's what slot receivers do.
Well, but occasionally you can send them, you know, out deep just to throw things off. But
of course,
his best trait, I think, is just keeping him in that short range. Let's go to the third guy, part of the young trio from last year. Kevin Harmon didn't really come on early. It took them a while to figure out how to work him into the offense. But
that's because Paul Richardson was on the team.
Oh, I forgot about Paul Richardson.
Yeah.
I forgot about you, Paul. And there's a reason.
It's easy to forget about.
Yeah. But when Harmon did come in, you know, he kind of became that third weapon. And when you've got a slot spot set, and you got McLaurin, who kind of was the speed guy, kind of the deeper threat, Harmon became the mid-tier guy, and he filled in that role very well. He's very good at getting open over the middle of the field and, you know, taking a big hit. He showed that he can be a good, reliable possession target. I don't think his numbers were outstanding, but if you just look at, like, the last three or four games, he had good games those last couple weeks.
You know, I first noticed Kevin Harmon when I watched Jimmy Moreland's college film out of James Madison, and I kept seeing Harmon beat Jimmy Moreland in that game. I think the only real downside to Kevin Harmon is he's not fast.
No.
You know, he's running in the 4.6 range. He's not the guy who's going to take the top off the defense. He's not the guy who's going to keep the safeties deep, which is what taking the top off the defense means. Mm-hmm. But he's a quality route runner. He's big guy. He knows how to use his size. He knows how to use his strength. And he came on, and he's another one of these guys that came on. He's a pretty good route runner. I don't think he's at Terry McLaurin's level, but who is?
Right.
Almost nobody's at that level.
But when he gets
open,
he's
a great move the chains possession guy. That's going to be his role on the team. He's a good red zone target. Mm-hmm. When you have a big guy with a big body who's not afraid to use it, that's what you want in a red zone player,
right?
In part, at least. He's a good receiver. I think he's only going to get better. This is why I wasn't ever really too worried about the receiver core. I mean, I know you've got the yutzes in the national media who say the Redskins got the worst receivers in football and all that stuff.
Yeah, I know.
Forget about all that. What is great about this group to me, you've got a real good core group of three.
Yeah.
Who are all learning, growing, and growing together with a young quarterback. Mm-hmm. And they have more talent than you might think. Just because the team sucked last year for a variety of reasons, it really wasn't because of the receivers.
No.
You know, this group of three, McLaurin, Sims, Harmon, have a potential to be great. In coming years, it's going to take a while to get there.
Yeah.
But I think those three guys are your core, and I don't think you need to replace them with Amari Cooper or somebody like that.
I think the most telling thing I saw one of the beat writers mention about these three guys is if you really average out, you know, McLaurin played the full season, so he can be a 1,000-yard guy. I don't think we have any question there. But if you average out what Sims and Harmon both did in the like the last part of the season, they're both in the, like the 750 range in a full season now. Like, you know, if they play and start,
if you kind of prorate that out,
yeah. They're both at like what I would, and that's where I consider the number two receiver level. They're both at that point in terms of what kind of yardage they could put up, and that's huge.
I mean, yeah, okay. So Harmon, in terms of numbers, last year played 16 games, started 8, 44 targets, 30 receptions, 365 yards, 12.2 yards per reception, no touchdowns. But like you said,
started
if
eight.
You look at
– yeah.
Yeah, started 8. And if you look at his game logs, he didn't really do much in the first half of the year. It was really week 10 going forward where he really came on.
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, and so, yeah, if you project that out to a full 16 games
– yeah, he's a 600 to 800-yard guy, that sounds like. And you know what? If he's your possession receiver, that's a great number two option. And Sims, his numbers are kind of similar in that regard, whereas once he starts and once you see him starting to get the ball a lot, he could be similar numbers-wise.
So, yeah, I didn't go over Sims' numbers early. His numbers, 56 targets, 34 receptions, 310 yards, four touchdowns. And then he also had 9 rushes for 85 yards. And in terms of Sims's game logs and when he came on and whatnot.
Right.
Again, it was sort of toward the end of the year. It was really, when he was really became more consistent was really starting in the Carolina game.
Right.
Kind of going forward.
Right.
You know, so they're both going to get better. And that's why I'm very optimistic about this group.
I am very too. I really am too. Let's move on. That kind of covers the core of our group from last year in my mind. So let's move to some of the new guys. Cody Latimer, who we took from New York. He's had an interesting offseason, let's say that. we kind of covered the whole situation with him out in Denver with, you know, what happened there.
Okay, so briefly, Cody Latimer was arrested on felony weapons charges. I tried to get the Douglas County, Colorado sheriff to give me the police report. They refused, which isn't surprising, but I did try. But the story that his lawyer told the media was that he pulled a gun on someone who allegedly had abused his son in some way.
Right.
I don't know what's true and not true. The charges haven't been dropped. They're still pending. You know, I guess the only thing I'll say to that is, as awful as that sounds, the way to handle it is not to pull a gun on somebody, because this is what happens. It's still a felony.
Yeah.
It's still going to ruin your NFL career. I think in terms of, you know, they brought Latimer in after they lost out on Amari Cooper.
He was kind of brought in as an insurance option, I feel like, at this point. Now, we don't know what's going to happen with the lawsuit. If he is on the team,
it's not a lawsuit. It's a criminal charge is the difference.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah. We don't know what's going to happen there.
No.
If he is on the team, I think it was actually a very sneaky good signing, because if you watch his play with the Giants, he has a knack for being – he's another move-the-chains kind of guy more than, you know, the big playmaker. But he's a very good acrobatic catcher. Like, he's got a talent for diving for balls and getting them, the one-handed catches. That's the kind of stuff he does well. And so I think a guy like that, you know, I'm hoping he's not a starter, and I – obviously, we don't know if he'll even be on the team, but it's not a bad backup option for the guys we have.
I mean, he's about the size of Kelvin Harmon.
Right.
He's 6'3", 220-something pounds.
They're a very similar type of player.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Very similar type of player. I was excited to have him on the team before all this criminal stuff happened, because I think he could, like you said, he has some athletic ability. He can make some crazy catches. I think he would be another guy who's a good red zone target. It would have been a good vet. He would have been a good veteran to have on the team. Mm-hmm. I just think with the criminal stuff hanging, it seems unlikely he's going to play, whether he's suspended or whether he's just gone, one or the other. It seems unlikely that this problem is going to get completely solved prior to the season.
Yeah, yeah. And I hate to say it, you know, even if what he claims is true, like you said,
it's not an excuse.
It can't be. It's not a legal excuse. You know,
no, it's not. Yeah. You know, like what case did I just read about? Here's another example. Oh God, the Botham John case out in Texas. This was last year. So this is a guy who was sitting in his apartment eating an ice cream cone on a couch. And an off-duty police officer, a woman,
walked into
the wrong apartment
and shot him.
Freaked out and shot him. And she was very convincing on the stand as a witness. She cried. You know, she said it was a mistake. I think everybody in the courtroom pretty much knew it was a mistake. But the jury convicted her. You know, and because it's still murder and you still killed somebody. And
sure.
It is, her sentence was affected by that. She got a short sentence out of it. That's kind of the term. That's the Cody Latimer situation. You know, let's assume it's true and something happened to Cody's son. You know, it was alleged to be sexual abuse. If that's true, it's still, you still pulled a gun on him. It's still felony
right.
assault.
Now you
the
won't
sentence
get
may
the
be
full
less
sentence.
Because,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah. The book probably won't be thrown at you if it's true, you're going to have some time or something. Some kind
right.
of penalty.
And that's just not the way to handle it. And, no. You know, while we understand and sympathize right. with that, it's not the way to handle it. It's still a
like
felony.
Even I don't have kids. I can totally understand and rationalize why he did it. But
I'd like to think that I would be smart enough to not do that, but you just never know.
Sure.
But the problem is,
sure.
You know, it's a felony.
Right. And I understand that too. And
that all may be a total lie, by the way. This is just his attorney said. It could be totally
true.
Wrong.
That's true too.
We don't know.
We never know.
You never believe in a defense attorney who's talking to the media because he's not telling facts. He's trying to convince the media of his side of the story.
Sure. That's a good point. All right. Let's move on to the big man we drafted out of Liberty, Antonio Gandy-Golden. The more I've read and learned about this guy, I think he's actually a superhuman from the future because he's got he's freak athletic talent. Like, he's probably, you know, top 1% of the world in that. He's intellectually gifted, borderline, like, genius, it sounds like. He's an artist, a musician. He does all these weird puzzle things that he's extremely good at solving, like, logic puzzles and stuff like that. So he's a superhuman. And he's now our big man 50-50 wide receiver.
I did a deep dive into his film.
Yeah.
There's a film study on our website if you want to watch it. And watch, I think, did I do a –
I
still haven't done the
site.
YouTube.
Yeah.
Oh, I know I wrote one.
Yeah.
And put the clips on there. I don't think I did a separate YouTube thing because this just takes so much time. I haven't dredged up the energy. But look. He had a really bad quarterback at Liberty.
Yes.
Stephen Buckshot Calvert. And Liberty is a Virginia school, and so a lot of you out there probably, you know about
it. Yeah, I think if you're a local, you know Liberty.
Yeah, and Calvert was celebrated at the Liberty level. But the fact of the matter is he put AGG in a horrible position mm-hmm. a lot. I think Antonio Gandy-Golden is a case of him being a big fish in a small pond. I'm not sure we're going to be able to see him do a lot of the things he did at Liberty in the NFL.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he made a lot of fabulous catches. One, because the ball was drastically underthrown or overthrown, placed in the wrong position, thrown way too late. The quarterback was just terrible.
Yeah.
But he's not going to be able – and Golden does have – and Gandy-Golden has a huge wingspan, enormous catch radius. But I think that there's a little bit of a big fish in the small pond scenario here. I don't think he's going to be nearly as explosive in the NFL. I really frankly think he's a classic possession receiver in the NFL just because of his size, his wingspan, his ability to jump. I don't necessarily think he's the greatest route runner in the world by NFL standards. He's not that fast by NFL standards, but he can be a great possession receiver. You know, one of the two of Kelvin Harmon and AGT are going to start long term in the future. I don't know which one. But I just think you have to take AGG with a grain of salt a little bit because of who the quarterback was. The quarterback created a lot of those fabulous plays by throwing terrible footballs, and he's playing against Division II corners who just aren't worthy of him. You know, you throw him in the NFL, and it's going to be a different story, I think.
Yeah, well, but again, that's not on him. That's on the quarterback. So,
I agree completely. Yeah. I'm just saying if he was at LSU, he might still be in the NFL. But I don't think we'd be going, oh, my God, look at what he did, because it was just a different scenario.
Yeah, it'd be
scenario.
I got you.
I think AGG is a classic NFL possession receiver.
Yeah, I think so, too. He's going to be a 50-50 guy and a red zone guy, I think, at best case.
Oh, yeah, for sure. That's his ballpark there.
And so we've seen how that works with a guy like Josh Doctson. The difference is if AGG has Josh Doctson's year like his last year here when he had 500 yards and
heart, talent, ability to.
Well, but I'm just talking numbers. If he does that as a fourth or, you know, day three pick, you're going to be happy. The problem with getting a guy like that at number one, we did with Doctson, you're going to be let down if he's not a superstar. But I don't think
Doctson seemed to ever care about the NFL.
Well, there was that too.
Too much.
But my point is, these kind of role players are fine to get where we got them. And I think that's kind of what his role is going to be. I expect to see, and this is getting ahead of ourselves, but I kind of expect when we get into the red zone, you're going to probably see AGG go in for like a Steve Sims guy because you'll want more size in the red zone. That's kind of how we'll utilize him.
Absolutely. And he can listen. The dude can get balls over 90% of the NFL secondary players out there because he's got such long arms. He's 6'4". He's huge. He can leap. You know, he's got a big vertical leap.
Right. He's the guy you put in the back corner.
He's going to be great. Finally, Jay Gruden is gone, and finally he's got his fade pattern, end zone fade pattern guy.
Yeah, it only took them losing Gruden to finally find a guy who could do it.
Exactly right. But is AGG going to be a Pro Bowler? I don't know about that.
I don't know about that either. Okay, rookie that we've picked up was Jonathan Johnson. I think we got him after the draft, correct?
Yeah. He is an undrafted free agent out of Missouri. He's little. He's wee. He makes Steve Sims look big. He's 5'8", 170 pounds.
Yeah, that's what I basically wrote. Steve Sims minus one or two. You know,
he's a burner. You know, he's got a ton of speed. Yeah. That's his thing. You know, they're under no obligation to him. I mean, he's got a min salary.
Right.
You know, undrafted free agent contract. All you can say about a guy like this is he's going to get his shot.
I mean, what I look at him as is if Steve Sims is your go-to slot guy, this is the guy you keep on the practice squad eventually if Sims gets hurt. You know, like that's kind of what – because you need a slot guy. Every week you're going to need a slot guy. So if Sims is out, you need somebody else to kind of fill that role, and this guy can do that. You know, good luck to him. I watched some of his film. I see some speed once he gets the ball, but he seems to lollygag on his routes a lot from what I saw.
That's possibly why he's an undrafted free agent.
Probably. all right, let's move on to – I'm going to go back to some guys who have been here. Let's do Mr. Irrelevant, Trey Quinn. Is this his fourth season now or third season? This is third season.
Yeah.
We've talked about him a little bit in the past, in the whole, he's a Mr. Irrelevant guy. They usually don't last this long anyway. So if he makes a roster at this point, I'm going to be a surprise because he's always hurt.
He's beaten the odds.
Yeah, he has. He's already beaten the odds, and he's a top five Mr. Irrelevant of all time. So good for him. But I don't see him lasting because he's always hurt, and that's the problem.
There's too much competition on this team, you know, to keep him around. It's hard to be disappointed in a guy who's Mr. Irrelevant, so I guess I shouldn't say that's not fair. I don't think he's going to develop. I don't think he has enough speed. I don't know what to say about him. I think he's going to be gone.
Yeah, I'm with you. Let's see. Cam Sims. Let's move on to Cam Sims. Kind of similar situation.
My 2019 camp crush.
Yeah, mine too, because we all wanted that big-bodied, you know, deep target in the red zone. But he just hasn't really shown anything. You know, he's been here 3-4 years now.
No. 2018, 3 years.
Yeah, 3 years. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. So 2 years. Well, if you now where he hasn't really done much.
Yeah, if you watch him at Alabama, he was the slot receiver at Alabama, and he had Jalen Hurts, mm-hmm. who at Alabama at least was a bad quarterback in terms of, he was a great runner. Not a great passer, and he had Calvin Ridley, who was the primary target. So he was drastically underused and misused at Alabama. What I kept seeing with Sims at Alabama is basically he was there to take a flat pass.
Mm-hmm.
That was 90% of the time he would line up for the flat pass, or he'd be a blocker for Jalen Hurts. They drastically underused him. Apparently, the Redskins noticed him at the pro day, Alabama's pro day. I still think he has talent. He's another guy, like you said, big body, 6'5". He's a much better receiver than Alabama ever gave him credit for. But, you know, he kind of got ruined when he got hurt there as a rookie and went out for the whole season. And now he's another guy who has a ton of competition, and he's going to be hard-pressed to make the team, I think.
I think so, too. Last guy from that kind of group that we're going through right now, Darvin Kidzie Jr., who's been with the Redskins, I think, since 2018. Or maybe it was just last year. But he's been here for a while. Practice squad guy. Another slot guy / returner, kind of similar to Steve Sims in that regard. Really more of a camp body, more of a depth chart, you know, keep him in reserve type person. Hasn't done a whole lot. A little. I think he played in one or two games, but that's about it.
He did.
Yeah.
I actually have a higher opinion of Darvin Kidzie,
really?
Believe it
okay.
or not. Yeah, he's a 2018, by the way, out of Texas Southern. He's bigger than Sims. He's 6 foot, 180 pounds, so he's a little taller.
Mm-hmm.
He looks like an NFL receiver to me. In the little time he played, I think he ran decent routes. He's got a decent amount of speed. He's a good combination of skills, size, and speed.
He's not elite in any of them. That's probably his takeaway.
No, but, I mean, I don't think anybody should expect him
no,
to be.
No.
I think of all this group, I actually think he's the one that's going to make the team.
Mm.
I think he could possibly be number 6 on this team because I think he's NFL-worthy. I think he's got enough of a combination of hands, size, speed, and route-running ability that he can actually make a career out of the NFL.
Sure.
Believe it or not, I think he's
okay.
the one.
Yeah, I mean, if you want to think that, you can think that. No one's going to stop you from thinking, Steve.
They might think I'm dumb for saying that, but that's what I – listen, I mean
– I think he'll get a shot because I think he showed enough the last few years in whatever, you know, training camp and stuff. Like, he's decent. I think there's a lot of guys who've come in who are pushing him down the roster. That's the tricky part.
Mark my words, people.
All right.
He's going to make the roster.
All right. Well, let's go to from your sleeper to my sleeper. The other rookie okay. that we took after the draft, Isaiah Wright.
How did I know you were going to
yeah, of course.
You're going to say
I'm
this.
I'm not going to hide it. He's a Temple guy, so I'm going to root for my guys. He's an interesting person to watch play because in my mind, he's actually more like Antonio Gibson than a wide receiver. He played a lot of running back in college and played if you look at his numbers, it's a pretty even split between runs versus receptions, and he's a very good kick returner. I like him for those things. I know it's probably going to be tough for him to make the roster, but, if he does, I think it's as a special teams guy.
Yeah, listen, he's bigger, 6'2", 220 pounds.
Yeah.
He's another guy who's got a decent combination of size and speed.
Yeah, he does.
And anybody who has that is going to have a chance to make
his weakest point is that his hands aren't great. That's why he was really a running back, even though they lined him up at receiver in college. I think that's going to be tricky. To me, he's, again, like Antonio Gibson, he's more of a gimmick guy where you're going to line him up in a lot of places if you want to use him. Let's also go. All right. So we got 1, 2, 3 more. Jester Way out of Pittsburgh, who I don't know about you, Steve. I tried finding info on this guy.
There's not a lot.
Not a lot. I don't even know what he did at Pittsburgh, frankly, because I looked up his highlights. I found one catch.
Look, Jester Wee, first of all, bigger guy, 6'3", 190 pounds,
yeah.
Undrafted free agent, 2018. He's a practice squad guy. You know, that's how the Redskins came across him. They signed him to the practice squad.
Right.
you know, what can you say about him? You're right. There's not much on him. I'm not going to pretend like I've watched a ton of Jester Wee film, you know, because I haven't, and there isn't a lot of Jester Wee film. He has been active a little bit here and there. I think he came on. I think he made. I'm about ready to pull it up here. Here we go. Yeah. So he was on the active roster in the last week of the season. So he actually was active for one game.
Oh, okay. I didn't remember that.
But he's yeah. But he came from the Houston Texans. He bounced around with Houston for 2 years. You know, he came on in the 2018 offseason. Was on their practice squad. Got cut last August, and then came to the Redskins in October, spent 1 week active. You know, what can you say? He's a guy on the team.
Sure. He is a guy on the team. That's what we can say.
Yeah, exactly.
Let's go to another guy on the team, and that's Emmanuel Hall, who's not a rookie. It's his second season now in the NFL.
I do have Emmanuel Hall news.
Okay. Okay.
Believe it or not, Emmanuel Hall has torn his Achilles.
Oh, so he's done.
He's done. This is why you come to us, people, because we do things like monitor Emmanuel Hall's Instagram. Emmanuel Hall put out on Instagram this week that he tore his Achilles this offseason doing training.
Oh, that, so he's got a history of injuries, too. Like, I know at Missouri he missed some time with some serious injuries like that.
Yeah. The Redskins may keep him and put him on
– stash him.
You know,
yeah,
stash him on IR or something, but he's not going to play this year because of his
injury. Well, that's a shame because he's – like I found some film of him in college because I think he's been hurt a lot. And the college film I found, he's more like a Terry McLaurin type where he does everything.
Yeah.
He probably doesn't have that speed, but he also has the injury bug, so you got to watch out for that.
Yeah.
All right, last guy.
So best up in your recovery.
Yeah, Emmanuel good Hall. Luck, Emmanuel. And, you know, maybe the team will just stash him like you said.
Yeah.
Last guy I have on the list, Jordan Veazey, who?
I'm just kidding. I said who.
Yeah. Well, okay, so he's in his second year out of California, kind of more of a tight end joker type than a traditional receiver when you watch him. He's slow. Kind of lumbers a little bit, plays out of H-back and spots like that time to time. He's got, 221, 6'3", so he's got that kind of build.
Yes.
I think you got to say long shot to make the roster. If he does, that's kind of the role you'd put him in, not a traditional receiving role.
Yeah. Yeah, but listen, some of these guys who had been automatic cuts are actually helped by the fact that, one, Cody Latimer is probably not going to be there.
Yeah.
And then Emmanuel Hall is gone because of injury. And so one of these guys that we've been talking about, these back-of-the-roster guys, has a shot to make it.
Yeah.
You know, the Jester Wees, the Isaiah Wrights, Jordan Veazey, Jonathan Johnson. Don't be surprised if one of those guys makes it. Darvin Kidzie, a couple of them, just because the Redskins have lost a couple guys.
Yeah, I agree. I agree very much with that. So, Steve, why don't we do who has your receiving roster listed.
Okay.
And we'll go from there.
Okay. So when I did my rosterbation article, this was back in, when did I do this? Back in May. How I originally had it was McLaurin, Harmon, Sims are your starters. Cody Latimer was your number four, and AGG number five, Darvin Kidzie number six, with Jonathan Johnson and Cam Sims on the practice squad.
Mm.
Cody Latimer, I think, is one way or the other going to be either suspended or gone. Emmanuel Hall is injured, but the real spot is Latimer. If Latimer's gone, one of these guys can make it.
Sure.
Do they keep Trey Quinn because he's a veteran? You know, do they bring Isaiah Wright on? Tough to say.
No,
you know,
until
if I
we
have
see
to
camp,
pick one,
it's going to be very tough. Yeah.
Yeah. If I have to pick one, I'd probably go with Jester Wee. But for no other reason than the Redskins know him. They've seen him. I think he can play a little bit. You know, I think the group, the obvious ones, the locks, McLaurin, Harmon, Sims, AGG is going to make the team.
Sure.
He's a fourth round draft pick. You know, I think Kidzie's going to make it, like I said. And so that's five. If they keep six, is it Cam Sims? You know, big guy, 6'5", maybe. You know, is it a guy like Jester Wee, Jordan Veazey? It's really going to be who can beat can beat out the other guys in camp. But I think your competition for the spot, VZ, we realistically VZ, we and Sims, and then Wright and Johnson have kind of a long shot, you know, to make it.
Sure. Sure. So
if make me pick one, I'm going to go with Jester Wee, but for no real reason.
So for me, I mean, I think we all are in agreement. The whole Redskins Nation is agreement that McLaurin, Sims, Harmon, and AGG are going to be your top four. With McLaurin and Harmon probably starting on the outside, Sims is in the slot. Like I kind of said earlier, I think AGG, you bring him in situationally at first when you get in the red zone. Pull out Steve Sims because you want bigger bodies in there. Maybe even pull out McLaurin from time to time, too, because McLaurin's only, what, 6 foot one, 6 foot? He's not a huge guy.
Yeah, he's 6 foot.
Yeah, so you might even pull him out, put AGG in on that side, so you have somebody who can do a fade route from time to time. That's going to be more of a situational thing. If Latimer somehow doesn't go to jail or whatever happens to him, I think he is in at five because I think he actually has some real football talent.
Oh, there's no doubt that if he's available, he's going to make the team. I was working on the assumption one way or another he's not going to be available.
Right.
But if he's available, what I'd set out the window, Latimer makes the team.
Right, and I think he's also a good balanced weapon, like as far as receiver. But I'm assuming he's not.
You know, you have
be
a vet
with you.
Yeah, he is a vet and can be a good influence.
Right.
Assuming he didn't try to kill somebody.
Right. Right. If he's not here, I've got Wright and David Kidsey both as like 6 and 5 respectively.
You got to stick up for your guy.
Well, here's my reasoning. I think that you're not going to want to have Steve Sims on kick return duties anymore. He's too valuable to the offense. I think you're not going to want to put Antonio Gibson back there too often on kick and punt return duties. And both Kidsey and Isaiah Wright are good kick returners, or at least they were in college. So I think you keep those guys on as your depth options to also play that special teams role.
I actually think Gibson may end up being the principal returner.
I think he might start, but I'm one of those guys who says you don't put a valuable offensive weapon back there where they can get hurt more.
My only real question for you on this is Matt Ioannidis going to be mad at you for cheating on him with Isaiah Wright?
No, it's an open thing.
Oh, it's an open relationship? Good.
It's an open relationship, Steve. It's fine.
Maybe there might even be a threesome action going on at some point.
And let's put practice squad, let's just say Jonathan Johnson, because like I said, I think you're going to need a slot guy in the practice squad.
I put Johnson on the practice squad, and I'm still going to stand for Cam Sims, so I'm going to give him a practice squad spot.
I like Cam, too. Let's say he'll also be on the – because you get, what, 12 guys on the practice squad? It got bigger.
Yeah, they're going to keep more than one receiver,
than
one of these guys. There's going to be at least two receivers on the practice squad.
So let's say eight guys
total.
I still
think Cam Sims is
–
I still say Sims has talent. And listen, with Latimer out, they need another big guy. It's not beyond the pale to think that Sims – makes the
that's
team
because
he is far more experienced than these other guys.
Yeah. And
I just again I had no real reason for saying particularly.
Yeah.
You know, it's any of these guys could make it, but Sims, experienced guy, taller, you know,
so
big dude.
We're in agreement though. There's probably two spots on the active roster and two spots in practice squad that are still available to everybody outside those top four guys. So let's move on. We forgot to talk about our poll this week, Steve.
Oh, God, we did. Yeah, let's do the poll.
Yeah, because it wasn't really a football topic in terms of the Redskins. It was just a poll that we just randomly did.
I'm glad you remember, because I totally forgot
about
it.
Right.
Okay, so the poll. Should the NFL allow fans and stands this upcoming season? Our rationale for this is that we're seeing baseball try to stumble on, stumble back into things.
Stumble is a nice way to put it.
Yeah, exactly. Basketball, NBA is coming back on. Some sports are, having some fans there. There's there's a horse race coming up. It's going to have partial fans and stands.
Is it Baltimore?
Yeah,
Pimlico,
I can't remember. I can't remember. But regardless, NASCAR is having some fans in the stands. So the point of the poll here is, what should the NFL do? Should the NFL allow fans in the stands this upcoming season? Four options: yes to the max allowed by the various applicable governments. Yes, however, we need one plan for every team. Yes, but let each team decide, meaning it's your stadium, you decide how many players you want in it, or just flat out, no, it's a dumb idea. So, Alex,
Sure.
What do you think, and what do you think the people would vote for?
Oh, I have no idea what the fans are voting for. I'm going to say they're going to just say yes. I'm not sure.
Well, there's three different yeses, so you got to pick one.
Oh, yes, maximum allowable then.
Okay.
I think realistically you're going to have to do – it's going to be whatever the state governments allow, because I got news for you. If the NFL says we want to have 80,000 fans and the city or state comes along and says – no, you can only be a quarter capacity. You're only going to be a quarter capacity. You're not going to be able to beat them.
Right.
So that's more of a logic thing for me.
What I think is a dumb idea, I actually agree with you. I think the NFL is probably going to want to let in as many as possible. But the simple fact of the matter is, like, that dope who runs California, Gavin Newsom, mm-hmm. is not going to allow fans in the stands, most likely. Whereas, like, you go to Florida, Ron DeSantis is going to allow as many fans as possible because that's just the policy of the local governments.
Right.
So I think that's what the NFL is going to do. But I don't think it's a very good idea to just let each team decide for themselves. I think the NFL actually needs to have a coherent plan mm-hmm. league-wide.
And I think those plans should involve your city and state.
Absolutely. You know. I mean, what are they going to do? Just thumb their nose at the governor? They can't.
No.
So I think what they're going to have to take a look at is league-wide, in every location, what can be done, set some sort of league policy. But at the end of the day, the NFL owners are going to want as many people in the stands as possible because it's a lot of money.
Right.
That's
and
line.
I think, like I said, the logical answer is that answer,
Yeah. There's a few comments here. And by the way, thanks everybody here for voting everything. We realize that some of these off-season polls are
weird,
stretching it a
weird.
Little bit. Yeah. Dave, our buddy Dave, our regular, we love you, Dave. He said, use a reasonable percentage of their max capacity for each stadium to determine how many can – he's got it mixed up here a little bit. But to determine how many can attend mm-hmm. each game is what he's trying to say. He said, hell, we've been setting that bar for nearly two decades now. And that's a good point to raise, which is – the Redskins' core group of 10,000 season ticket holders can just go spread out.
Right, right.
You know, we're not going to lose a single fan if the stadium capacity is reduced.
You can't all sit together clumped at the 50-yard line. You got to take over the second tier and, one person every two seats kind of thing.
I'll read John Worrell, even though he wrote yet another super long comment. So that I'm going to abbreviate because I can't read it all. But what he said is, John Worrell of IJB fame, we love you, John. He said, if the season happens, which remains in doubt, it should be possible for stadiums to allocate seating in a manner that permits social distancing. Dots for bathroom, beer, food, ticket lines, mask mandatory when not at seats. Mm-hmm. I think there is zero doubt that the season's going to happen. The season will 100% happen. For sure, they will move heaven and earth to make it happen. But the rest of it, I also don't think that masks should be mandatory. I don't agree with some of what he's saying, but that's John's opinion. But one thing I do say is, listen, the NFL is going to make the season happen. There's too much money to not happen, let's see. Here's a Scott G, who's at 20G Dog, says, if you want football for the entire season, no fans. So he voted no.
So that's more of a be overly cautious kind of thing, which I can understand that mentality, too.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. For sure. Gabrielle Wood, who is at GCH Wood, I think he's written in before. He said, I wouldn't go to FedEx if the government mandated it. I'll still watch them on TV, though. Even if the government makes them, he wouldn't go. I don't blame you, frankly.
Nope.
It costs too much.
Nope. I don't blame you.
Let's see here. Last one, then we'll move on. Kevin from Chicago says, in accordance with the government regulations, PPE, which is personal protective equipment, social distancing, et cetera, don't keep us from our beloved Redskins. He must be one of the 10,000 that are still season ticket holders.
Sure, sure. And again, this is one of the things that'll be interesting to watch throughout the, course of things. And, my mentality is have a plan, but also realize in the end that if something changes, let's say New York has another massive outbreak. I could also see them saying, all right, we had fans for this part, but now you can't have fans for a while because we have a problem,
Well, that's why, I mean, no matter what the NFL wants, local governments and state governments are going to set a policy that they set, and there's nothing the NFL can do about it. Where I disagree with John Morrill over is there's no doubt the season's going to happen. They're going to make it happen.
Yeah,
because there's many billions of dollars at stake, so it will happen no matter
what. I agree with that, too, that I think there's no way the NFL doesn't happen. Even though there might be some hiccups along the way, I just think people need to – you're going to have to roll with some things as a fan. Like, hey, if a player's sick, they're not going to play, and you just need to accept that. Like, you know, that kind of stuff.
Oh, that's a whole nother story. Yeah. I mean, we're going to probably get into it on JB, but, you know, like the NBA is allowing for Major League Baseball is allowing for
special roster
coronavirus lists, roster things, and the NFL may have to do some of that. But whether or not they allow fans in the stands, which is our question, I think is a combination of the NFL wanting to sell as many tickets as possible. But the overriding factor is what the local governments will allow.
And I agree with – I think, you know, even though you and I are on different sides on a lot of this stuff, like overall I think we're in agreement roughly as to what the plan's going to be for them.
And also remember, this is September. This is a couple months from now. Right. You know, who knows what the world is going to look like, you know, in 2 months.
Right. We don't know what it's going to look like in 2 days. So I'm not going to.
The world may burn down in before then, and we won't have a planet Earth.
Yeah. Yeah. Who knows? Do we want to get to any of this other stuff, or we're over an hour already, I feel like.
I can't remember what other stuff it is, quite honestly.
We had the RG3 did an interview. I mean, if people are interested, care.
If you want to listen to RG3, fine. Yeah. I don't really care what he has to say. I liked him as a player. You know, I thought given a better coach in a different circumstances and less ego, he could have been a good player. But he prattles on too much. I get sick and tired of his mouth and all of his preaching. And if you want to listen, feel free. Good score by John Kime to get him, but I didn't care enough to listen.
I listened, and my thing is the stuff that you did wrong, you're still doing wrong. At RG3, he's like, oh, I think I proved to that everyone that it wasn't my fault. And it's like, no, it's still your fault, dude. Like,
well, yeah, and just because you made the Baltimore Ravens as Lamar Jackson's backup doesn't mean
you're
really
not very good
anything.
At that, by the way.
Well, he didn't play much. I think he's a great backup for Lamar Jackson, quite honestly.
Well, because he fits the style.
Yeah.
You don't have to change your scheme.
But in terms of that, I just don't listen, we've moved on.
Yep.
I don't care enough to spend an hour listening to him talk, and I get sick and tired of him preaching. He's one of these guys that needs to just shut up and play.
Well, I like to say he's got one of those calendars, the daily calendars by his computer where it's got like some inspirational bullshit quote, and he just rips it off, writes it down, and then like moves on. And
puts it in a tweet.
Yeah, and he acts like he came up with it. Which, that's what annoys me still with him.
I don't like being preached at, and he's a preachy one.
Yeah, he really
is.
Don't
preach at me.
Yeah.
Don't preach at me, bro.
Yeah, I don't need you telling me how to be better with my life, because yours ain't that great, even though you have millions of dollars.
Right, exactly. Athletes need to stop preaching at people, generally speaking,
yes.
I think.
Yeah.
Just play.
Yeah.
Shut up and play.
Generally speaking, and especially on social media these days. All right, well, I think that should just about do it for this week's episode. Because we're well over time at this point, even though I know we don't really care. But you have another podcast to record.
We're well over the time that Alex imposes on us for no reason.
Yes, but you have another podcast to record. So
I do have to go.
Yeah, you have to go and record IJB, and then you're done for the day.
I'm going to take a commercial break, and then I will be back.
Right, Steve's going to have to do a costume change.
Exactly.
All right, guys, have a happy 4th of July weekend, since I won't see you. And everyone take care out there.